love to say, well, it's because I'm a child of God, I'm down, and they're stifling me. Let me tell you something. The word of God says, no weapon that's fashioned against the child of God will prosper. Many times the reason we are where we are is because we are not praying enough. Sometimes even in the area of sicknesses. Now I'm not saying here today that we will not go through certain stuff and certain things. But I'm saying, brothers and sisters, many times the devil seems to defeat us because we're not praying enough.
All right.
There is power in prayer. Yes. Abraham prayed. His wife was barren. Abraham prayed and his barren wife's womb bore fruit. There's power in prayer. Joseph was thrown into a pit by his enemies. Yes, his enemies. They were his brothers, but they were his enemies. Not because folks are brothers and sisters in the church, it means that some of them are not your enemy. He was thrown into a pit by his enemies, but prayer got him out. Moses was struck by a Red Sea. Pharaoh's army, the superpower of the day, approaching on horses and chariots. Moses prayed and the Red Sea parted. There is power in prayer. The point is this, church. Let us use the weapon of prayer. Let us use it. Somebody here today is sick. Sick with maybe cancer, diabetes. Utilize prayer. Somebody's going through a family struggle, job struggle. I'm saying to you today, church, let us utilize prayer. There is power in prayer. God's desire is for his church to be a praying church. I say it again. God's desire is for his church to be a praying church, Sister Clemens. That's his desire. And so today we're going to talk about the power of prayer and go home. Jesus is our mother. As a matter of fact, we are called Christians because we are following Christ. We are called Christians because Jesus is our example. We are called Christians because we are supposed to reflect Christ. It therefore means, church, whatever Christ did, the world expects us to do. Whatever Christ did, heaven expects us to do it. Amen. And so Jesus must serve as our mother. And I want to say to you today, even though Jesus is God in human flesh, Jesus saw the need to utilize prayer. Imagine Jesus' divinity suppressed in humanity. And yet Jesus prayed. But if Jesus is God in human flesh, and he prayed, he saw the need for prayers. What about us? What about us? I'm saying to you today, church, God is calling us back to prayer. Amen. And so Jesus, our model for prayer. Let us look at the example of Jesus. Jesus began his public ministry with prayer. I'll say that again. Jesus began his public ministry with prayer. Before Jesus chose his disciples to go out and accompany him in the work that his Father sent him to do, Jesus spent 40 days and 40 nights in prayer and fasting before he went about the work that God assigned him to do. Jesus began with prayer. He started with prayer. Many of us, we go to work when the day comes, and many of us don't even pray. Many of us are involved in ministry, different ministries, and we believe that we can depend on our talents and our gifts alone. And we don't spend enough time in prayer. But I'm saying to you today, church, if our ministries are going to be effective, we've got to be people of prayer. Yeah. Jesus began his public ministry with prayer. Matthew chapter 4. Read it, help me to read verses 1 and 2. Matthew 4, 1 and 2. What it says, everybody?
Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered.
Jesus began his ministry with prayer. Before he chose the disciples, in other words, before he chose the friends that will walk with him and sleep with him, he prayed. Many of us, we choose our friends without even praying. Now, I'm not saying don't be friends with everybody. But many of us, we give ourselves to any and anybody without even the Lord's direction.
That's so
true. We've got to be people of prayer. Before you choose your husband or your wife, don't even look at handsome face and nice looks. You've got to pray. We must be people of prayer. Jesus, before he chose the disciples, he prayed. Before he began his ministry, his public ministry, he prayed. I'm calling the church today to prayer.
Amen.
Jesus began his daily life. His daily life with prayer. He began his daily life with prayer. Many of us get up in the morning and we are too busy to pray. Many of us rush to work and we are too busy to pray. Many of us are even too busy to have morning worship with our children. Jesus began every day with prayer. And not just prayer. Not just kneeling down and say, good morning, God. He spent quality time every morning in prayer. Church of the Living Lord, we don't know what the day holds. And so we have to begin our day with quality time in prayer. My aim today is to call the church back to prayer.
Amen.
Read Mark 1:35. What it says.
And in the morning. And
in the morning. Rising up a great while
before day.
The Bible says a great while before day. Now he will go out at daybreak. The Bible says he got up a great while before day. Continue, reader.
He went out.
He went out. In other words, he went apart. Apart from his loved ones, his disciples. Continue, reader.
And departed into a solitary place.
Into a solitary place.
And they prayed.
And they prayed. Let me tell you something, church. Praying with your children in the morning alone is not enough. Praying at devotion alone is not enough. If we're going to follow the example of Jesus Christ, we've got to get up and spend some personal time with God in prayer. We are living in the last days. It's time to equip ourselves spiritually to face the hurdles that are ahead of us. We've got to practice rising early in the morning. Go apart while your children are sleeping. Go apart and pray. Let's follow the example of Jesus Christ. Amen. And you know what? I guarantee you, if we do this, our day will be better. Amen. And so the Bible says that Jesus got up a great while before day and he went apart to pray. This is the example of Jesus. And so he began his public ministry with what? And he began his day with what?
Prayer.
With prayer. Number three, reader. Jesus concluded. He concluded his day with what?
Prayer.
With prayer. He began his day with prayer. He concluded the day with prayer. Let's read it to everybody. Luke 6, 12, what it says.
And it came to pass in those days that he went out into a mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God.
Hallelujah. Jesus did not pray at night in a hurry. Jesus ensured that he spent time in prayer. On one occasion, the Bible tells us he spent all night. All night in prayer. When last we spent all night in prayer? Ask yourself that question. You mean to tell us, to tell me, some of us, we have some problems? And all we do is say good night, God, and fall to sleep on our knees, and we are struggling with some issues. We are fighting some personal battles. I'm saying to you, church, if we are going to be victorious, we've got to learn to agonize with the living Lord.
Amen.
The Bible says Jesus concluded his day with prayer. There were times he spent all night in prayer. Jesus began his public ministry with what?
Prayer.
Jesus began his day with what?
Prayer.
Jesus went apart. Jesus went apart during the day. Jesus withdrew himself during the day for prayer. Church, I want to challenge all of us here today. During the day at your work, when you have a little break, don't spend all of it just eating and texting. Don't spend all of your break on the phone. I want to challenge you today. I want to challenge us to set aside time during the day just to pray. Even if it means going down into the parking lot into your car. Even if it means going for a walk on the road. And while walking, you are praying. Let us practice. Let us make an effort to spend some time during the day in prayer. And I guarantee you, if Jesus did it and his ministry was effective, our ministry and our lives will be effective too. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And so Jesus withdrew during the day for prayer. Luke 5:60. What it says, reader?
And he withdrew himself into the wilderness and prayed.
Hallelujah. Jesus' desire is for us to spend uninterrupted time in prayer. Luke chapter 22, 39-42. What it says, everybody? Let's read together.
And he came out. And went, as he was wont, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples also followed him. And when he was at the place, he said unto them, pray that he enter not into temptation. And he was withdrew from them about a stone cast, and kneeled down and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done.
Hallelujah. Now, church. Not every prayer God answers. You're going to get to the meat of it now. Not every prayer God answers. Are you following me? Not every time you pray and I pray, God hears you. As a matter of fact, Sister White says, every sincere prayer is heard in heaven. In other words, God wants our prayers to be sincere. And so not every prayer God hears. Yes, God wants us to be people of prayer. Said in Romans 12, rejoicing in hope, patience in tribulation, continuing what? Instant in prayer. God wants us to be people of prayer. But not every prayer God hears. Yes, he wants us to be people of prayer. Colossians 4:2, what he says, we are continuing in prayer.
And watch in the same with
thanksgiving. And watch in the same with thanksgiving. God wants us to be people of prayer, but not every prayer God hears. And so really we have come to what?
An unforgiving heart.
Hindrances. What can prevent our prayers from being answered? What are some of the things that can keep God from hearing our prayers? We want to know that every time we kneel down in the morning and cry for our children, God hears. We want to know that every time we withdraw during the day for personal prayer, God hears. We want to know that every time we kneel down at night to pray, God hears. We want to know that God is hearing our prayers.
Amen.
And so what are some of the things that can keep our prayers from being heard by God? What are some of them? Number one. An unforgiving heart. Church, the Bible is clear. If we bear malice in our hearts, God will not hear our prayers. That's the gospel truth. Mark 11:25, what it says.
And when he stand praying, forgive. If he has aught against any.
Hold on. Not if any has aught against you. We know this, the passage that says if you know your brother has aught against you, leave your gift at the altar and go and make it right. We know that. Am I talking the truth? But here the Bible is saying, if I have aught against any. If you have aught against any. This is what the Bible says. When ye stand praying, forgive. If ye have aught against any, that your Father also which is in heaven may what?
Forgive you your trespasses.
In other words, church, if we have an unforgiving heart, God will not forgive us when we pray. And sin separates from God. And so if we have people in our minds and we are bitter with them and we are mad, we don't love them, we hate them because of what they did, I'm saying to you, church, if we have that spirit, every time we kneel down, God will not answer our prayers. when someone you care about, this is a nice quote, when someone you care about hurts you, let me tell you something, the worst pain is when somebody you trusted hurt you. The worst pain, it's hard to give up, it's hard to get over. But listen to this, when someone you care about hurts you, you have a choice. I'm saying you have a choice. And nobody can have us do what we don't want to do. Are you listening to me? We've got to stop blaming people for how we behave. We have a choice. When someone you care about hurts you, you can what?
Hold on to the anger.
You can hold on to the anger. You really have a choice. You can hold on to the anger. You can what?
Resentment, thoughts of revenge.
You can hold on to the anger, resentment, thoughts of revenge. We can do that. You hurt me, I'm gonna get you back. We can do that because we have a choice. But there's something else we can also do. And so when someone you care about hurts you, you can hold on to anger, resentment, and thoughts of revenge. Or
embrace forgiveness.
Or we can embrace
forgiveness. And move forward.
Yeah. We have a choice. Yeah. When Adam and Eve sinned, they hurt God. Are you there, church? They sinned. Have you ever experienced hurt from your very children that you made? Oh, some of us, we have not experienced it yet because our kids are still small, right? And we pray that we don't. But let me tell you something. Some children can turn back and do some stuff to their parents out of this world.
All right.
Out of this world. I know a parent, her only child, raised that child as a single parent, carrying cassava bread on her head. You know what cassava bread, those of you who came from down south and you came from the Caribbean.
Yes.
Huh? Carrying cassava bread on her head, struggled and built a house. And when the child grew and fell in love, see this thing called love? It could cause some of us to do some foolish things. Fell in love and put the mother out. That parent, I know it, I saw it with my own eyes, I spoke to the parent myself. That parent lived in the yard. Covered by a tarpaulin. And our child, with the child lover, living in the house. Now, what would you have done as a parent? Don't answer. What I'm trying to tell you, church, some folks can do some stuff. And when those that are close to us, like the very children, God was hurt by his very children. And he had a choice. To destroy them or to forgive and move on. Let me tell you something, church. You know why we are here today? Because God chose to forgive.
Hallelujah. Amen.
That's why we are here today. And I stop by here today to tell somebody, let us choose to forgive.
Amen.
And move on. Hallelujah. When someone hurts you, you can hold on to the anger, resentment, and thoughts of revenge,
or embrace
forgiveness and do what? And move forward. That's a good, good thought, isn't it? Huh? Let me give you another one, because we want to define forgiveness. Listen, we run around church and we talk all kinds of things about forgiveness. Have you ever heard some folks, when we talk about forgiveness, we try to paint forgiveness in this way so as to make us look right.
Yes.
But listen, forgiveness is forgiveness. We can turn it around to suit us how much we want. I forgive you. But that doesn't mean I must talk to you. You never heard it? I forgive her. But that doesn't mean I must talk to her. I'm foolish. You never heard it, man?
Yes.
We take forgiveness and we turn it around to suit us. But forgiveness is forgiveness and we can't turn it around. What is forgiveness? Let's look at a few definitions. Forgiveness, one theologian said, is what? Let me read that.
Letting go of the need for revenge.
Hold on. If we still seeking revenge, we have not forgiven.
Amen.
Don't turn. If we are still seeking to get back, we have not forgiven.
Amen.
If we are still seeking to hurt the person who hurt us, we have not forgiven.
Amen.
The Bible says forgiveness is letting go.
Of the need for revenge.
Of the need for what?
Revenge.
Of the need for what?
Revenge.
Of the need for revenge. And what?
And releasing negative thoughts of bitterness and resentment.
And releasing. Bible says forgiveness is letting go of the need for revenge. When we forgive, we don't seek revenge. And release him. And release him.
Negative thoughts.
And release him.
Negative
thoughts
of bitterness and resentment.
Lord help us. Lord help us. Lord help us. Lord help us. Listen, church, I know we love to say, God is working with me. God has worked in the church 20 to 30 years, and you still shouting because you have not yet, we have not come to the point of forgiving those who hurt us. We still shouting, God is working with me. But if God has been working with us to forgive for 20 years, when we are converted, the first spirit that enters us is one of forgiveness. Because that's the first thing God did for us.
What we need to do is stop making excuses. And start to beg God to give us what we need so we can forgive.
Yes.
Because we have to stop making excuses. Yes. Gotta do it. Because if Jesus comes and meets us in that state, may God have mercy.
Yes.
Forgiveness, I love this quote. Forgiveness is letting go of the need for revenge.
And release him.
Negative thoughts of bitterness and resentment.
Another quote. Forgiveness is an act of compassion. Love expressed when you are sinned against. In other words, brothers and sisters, when folks hurt us, the unconverted response is to hurt back. But the converted response is to meet hurt with love. That's the response. Listen, church, let us all strive to come up a little higher. Let's strive to meet hate with love. Hallelujah! That's what God did when the woman was caught in the act of adultery and they dragged her. They dragged her with hate, believing that they were fighting for a just cause, believing that they were fighting to defend Moses' law. But the God of the law stood right there. Amen. And he met those who think they know it all. And they are pleased to defend right. He met them with love. And they came with anger and heat because of what this woman did. And you know what is the most hurtful thing? When you study the story, they set that woman up. They set her up. You could imagine, you know you're doing wrong and your bold face. To come in the very presence of God to play a defending right. God didn't embarrass them publicly. You know what he did? He wrote on the sand so that they can come and peep. Yeah, now you can peep and walk away. And he met that woman with love. He did not condone wrong. He did not condone sin. You know what he said? He said, go. 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 And sin no more. But when a sinner meets Jesus, a sinner can't leave. She can't leave. She stood there. She could not have left. She could not have left. Hallelujah.
Tune in next time for more of this sermon.
Doesn't have the money, doesn't have the means to pay. Have you ever borrowed and borrowed and borrowed? You don't know about that. You know about that? Huh? We have borrowed and borrowed and borrowed. You always promise it to pay back. But you know you can't pay it back, but you always promise it to pay back. Why do you think some of us is good credit card debt like that? Because we always, but the only thing that you borrow, you continue. Where are you here?